All right, maybe we can get going here today. Well, good afternoon. My name is Bill LaCouris, and I am the Dean of the College of Natural Mathematical Sciences, and probably the best news of the night. I used to do this when I first came here, and they gave me a sheet to read, and it was 14 pages long, right? I cut it down to 2, right? So, because we want to hear what the speakers have to say and not what I have to say so much. But on behalf of UMBC and the college, I'm pleased to welcome all of you, students, and hopefully you've been here without duress, the staff, faculty, alums, thank you for coming, and guests. This is our premier life science event for the college, and it's the 20th annual A Look Ahead, Explorations in Transformative Research. And what's really inspiring to be some type of, or bringing people along, is understanding why we do these things. And so that's the context of what I want to tell you, is that it's all about highlighting the research, the pioneer medical research that our faculty, students, and dedicated staff at UMBC do. And that's what the posters around the room are. And a lot of times we go to conferences and things and we stick within our own silos. But we get to mix across the borders from the students here and the faculty and the staff. And it's a chance for me to put some food out for people to enjoy as well. And on stage, we'll have an in-depth look at the research of one of our rising faculty. We'll also hear how an undergraduate education and the research experience that takes place at UMBC hopefully sets you up sets the stage for success. And we're going to hear from a distinguished alum from that point of view. And then hopefully, and I know it, that we'll be inspired by the transformative and applauded research of a celebrated scientist, educator, and mentor. So the college, the purpose of the college and the aim is to provide the tools and the resources for our faculty and students to succeed and to achieve great heights. And that's what we hope this event's all about, is to inspire you to see what we're doing, see what others have done that have been through the process, and what we can aspire to be with the knowledge that we have. And I'd like to take the opportunity to thank a few people. I'd like to thank the faculty and their excellence in both teaching and research. That's what this is, the product, a lot of it is, the posters. I'd like to thank the students for their quest for knowledge, their persistence, because sometimes it feels like forever you're in the laboratory, but persistence is important in doing research, because you go back and do things over and over sometimes. And their quest for a degree is important too, I think. I'm just joking about that. The department chairs for supporting the event, the staff, especially those that help pull this all together. Thank Caitlin and Rebecca for that. And there's numerous others, OIA, and numerous individuals across the campus and groups that help us put this event on that often go unseen. And I'd also like the generosity of the sponsor, Shepard Mullen. Don Petro is not here today, but he helps us every year to put this event on and pay for all the incidental costs that take place. So on behalf of thanking everyone, please join me in giving a round of applause on behalf of all those and show our appreciation. So now we're going to move on to the Look Ahead Talks, and we're delighted to have 3 distinguished scientists here with us today. There's in the books that you have, and if you don't have a book, you should pick one up. You can read the more detailed aspects of what we're talking about. But our first person that's going to be talking today is Michelle Starz-Gaiano. She's an associate professor in the Department of Biological Sciences and graduate program director of biological sciences. She's joined the faculty in 2008. And if you don't know what she's looked like, you should have come down the highway and look at the Jumbotron, where I walked up out of the garage and there was this enormous face of Michelle that was up there. Look, she's embarrassed now. I thought it was a beautiful picture, and I think it was a good symbol of of the people we have at UMBC. So I'm going to invite you to the stage.
Okay, I want to thank Dean LaCouris and everyone who is involved in organizing Look Ahead. I think it's a fantastic event, and I'm delighted to be here today to tell you about the work my lab's been doing. So the title of my talk is The Impact of Tissue Architecture on Cell Signaling During Animal Development. So I'm a developmental geneticist by training, and I was trained by Ruth Lehman, who's our speaker later, so I'm very excited to be sort of an opening act for her work. So what we think about as developmental biologists is how you go from a fertilized egg to a differentiated multicellular organism, a complex organism like yourself. So if you think about an egg and a sperm meeting to form the fertilized egg, that fertilized egg will have to divide into multiple cell types, but of course that doesn't do enough because you don't look like a big blob of lots of cells, but instead the cells have to decide what they're going to do, right? So this cell says, I'll be blue, and it tells the other cell not to be blue. And all those sorts of signals are really important over the course of development so that you can form the proper cells at the proper times. And so this requires communication between the cells, and then the cells have to work together to organize into the embryo. So in my slide here, we have different colors representing different cell types or precursors to different cell types. Those will go on to divide and move about the embryo. Maybe some will differentiate into neurons or into germline and form the shape of an embryo. While this is going on, you still have lots of cell signaling, cell communication, cells are working together. You have cell migration, which our lab is also interested in, and more cell division as well. So this is a representation of a mammalian embryo, but lots of embryos undergo the same kinds of processes, and we know that this is controlled largely genetically. These communication and teamwork types of events are also required during adulthood. So even after you have a fully formed organism, you require cells to communicate with each other and to send signals with each other so that they know what to do. For example, if you get hungry, some of your cells are going to say, you know, that your insulin needs to be regulated and you're going to respond by eating something. In this example, we have a cell that is responding to an infection and migrating to a new location. So these same kinds of signals are important throughout a multicellular organism's life. If you guys want to move over, there's more seats in the middle because I know you can't see over there. It wouldn't interrupt me, I promise. So we used fruit flies to understand development. So this is considered a model organism for other kinds of development because there are similar events that happen between fruit flies and other organisms, and they're genetically controlled in similar ways. And so the advantages of using fruit flies is that they have a fast generation time. There's tremendous genetic tools that we can take advantage of in the fly. So the genome is mapped. We know a lot of the genes that exist. We have strategies to do loss or gain of function genetics. And the genetic conservation is high with other animals, including humans. So if we identify something in fly, there's a good likelihood that it will have a similar function in humans. A big advantage in my work is that there are small and transparent tissues in the fly, which means that we can look at cell fates and cell decisions in their normal context. And so we can use that information more easily than, say, if you were looking in a mouse that was developing inside its mom. Can we have the AV person help with us? So if we look at the fly, which is behind this little menu, there he is, there she is, sorry. The fly you will see is sort of a flying abdomen full of eggs that's producing more baby flies, right? So it's converting food yeast into eggs. So it does this really well, it does this really quickly, and we can look at the different stages of development as we pull out an ovary, and we can see many stages at once. And so the ovary overall is depicted here, but if we focus in a few stages during mid-oogenesis, when the egg is forming, you can appreciate that there's two major cell types. So on the outer edge are small somatic cells, and inside are large or gigantic germline cells. And so this gray cell is going to give rise to the oocyte itself. The other cells are support cells. And the somatic cells are going to provide information to the egg and also form the eggshell of the future embryo. So we have been looking in particular at two cell types in the epithelium of the somatic cells, the polar cells, which are shown in yellow, and the border cells, which are a motile cell type. So that's part of why we're very interested in them, because they respond to the cues in the egg chamber by migrating, and we'll see that in a second. But if you look just, you guys see the shadow, right? There's a shadow. Are we going to be able to lower the lights, maybe? So if we look at eggs during their development and we stain them with fluorescent markers, we can appreciate a lot of the different cell types that, again, are coordinated in their development. And we can see the large germline cells are highlighted in blue by very large nuclei. And then the motile border cells are shown here in red. They migrate between the nerve cells to make it to the oocyte border behind the plant over there. So this is what this looks like in vivo. So we can make movies, and I hope you can see, even though the lights are a little bit high, that there's migrating cells in this egg chamber. So this egg chamber has green fluorescent protein specifically expressed in the border cells. And can you see them moving? Okay, good. So this is a very dynamic process. And we can use the ability to look in these small transparent tissues to study how they do these movements and how they do the specification. So today I'm going to focus on the initial events that allow the cells to become motile border cells. One of the things that was identified early on were a set of mutants that disrupted the ability of some cells to differentiate into those cells. So in an early egg chamber, again, this is the picture you saw earlier. The cells are sitting in the epithelium. At later stages, they are moved away from the epithelium and migrating. And we knew that they had high levels of a transcription factor called STAT, which is the signal transducer and activator of transcription. Mutant analysis from a number of different labs has shown that if you have no STAT activity, none of the cells become migratory. And there were a number of different mutants in this signaling pathway that gave that same phenotype, where everybody stayed in the epithelial layer. In addition, some labs had identified activating mutations in STAT, so you have higher levels of STAT activity, and that was sufficient to induce additional border cells, additional motile cells in the process. So that led us to conclude that the STAT pathway was necessary and sufficient for defining the motile cell population of border cells. So what is the STAT pathway? So STAT, I said already, stands for signal transducer and activator of transcription. It's turned on when an activating cell releases a cytokine or an extracellular signal, which can be released and then bound by a transmembrane protein. And that transmembrane protein is associated with the Janus kinase, or JAK. So JAK, upon the ligand binding to the receptor, JAK will be phosphorylated. It will phosphorylate the receptor, and STAT will be recruited from the cytoplasm, where it will also be phosphorylated by the JAK. And then the STAT dimerizes, moves to the nucleus, and turns on transcription. And so all of this is happening in the responding cell in response to an activating signal that was released nearby. Although it doesn't have to be nearby, but in this case it's nearby. So these are extracellular signals that activate the signaling pathway. So the signaling pathway is very well conserved. It's required for animal development. It's required for blood stem cells in humans, which was one of the ways it was identified initially. And it's overactivated in a number of diseases, including rheumatoid arthritis and other blood diseases. But we have a big advantage in flies again, which is that there's one component for each of these parts of the signaling transduction cascade that you see here, whereas in mammals, there's multiple overlapping components, so it's a little bit more complicated in mammals. So I had shown when I was a postdoc with Denise Montel that signals from the polar cells activate STAT in a gradient, and Doug Harrison's lab had a similar finding. So the polar cells are located here in this egg chamber, and as you move away from the source of the activating signal, you can see lower levels of STAT activation. The same is true for another downstream target of STAT signaling, which is called slow border cells. And if you quantify across this epithelial layer, the levels of STAT signaling, you can see it's high close to the polar cells and low as you move away. So that suggests that they're responding, the cells in the epithelium are responding to some diffusible signal potentially that allows STAT signaling to be activated. Stefan Niselli's lab has shown that they could identify the activating protein, which is called unpaired, in the region just below these cells. So it seems that they're specifically releasing the activator to one side, and that's what's detected in the picture here. And importantly, only cells with a very high amount of activator become the motor border cells, while other cells that have a lower level end up shutting down the pathway. So based on this work, we had a prediction, which was that if you look at the egg chamber from a top-down point of view, you would expect that you would see radially symmetric activation of STAT signaling around the two polar cells which are sending out the activator. We didn't initially have a way to do this experiment to test this idea because egg chambers develop in the strings that I showed you at the beginning, and so they like to be lying on their side. So my graduate student, Lathina Manning, had to develop a technique to separate them out and mount them so that we could do sort of an end-on imaging of these egg chambers. So she did that, and we found that our prediction was sometimes correct, which was exciting. So in this case, we can see the two polar cells are in the center, and then we have STAT activation shown in green all the way around. In another egg chamber with a different marker, we can see the two polar cells are here, and we have high levels of nuclear STAT, which is a readout for STAT activity. And again, it's radially symmetric in this case. And this was all the work of Lathina Manning. Oops. But much more often, our prediction was really not correct. So more often, we saw the polar cells here, the secreting cells that activate the pathway. And then to one side, we would see a bunch of cells that were responding. But these cells on the other side that were touching the activating cells even, they were not responding by activating STAT. And here's another example, again, with a different marker. So the two polar cells are in the middle. We have SLOBO antibody, which again, SLOBO is a downstream target of STAT. And it can be seen high in these cells on one side, but it's not detected on cells nearby. So not all cells that were contacting the activating cells were responding. And this was really confusing at first to us. And of course, we were worried at first that something was just wrong and we were doing a bad job. So we did a lot of controls to show that we can see all the cells. And when Lathina categorized all of the arrangements of STAT activity, she could see basically four different patterns. So the case that we expected in the first place, this radially symmetric pattern, is shown in the bar graphs in purple. And we have a few different ways of looking at the cells and different genetic lines. But you can see that at most half of the egg chambers would have this radially symmetric pattern. But most of the time, we would see these other patterns where we saw asymmetry, where activation was on one side of the polar cells. We would see one gap, or sometimes we would even see two gaps. And again, this is color-coded. So this two-gap case, you can see, is pretty high here. So we didn't have a very good sense of what would be going on to cause this. This is showing that other markers that we looked at were radially symmetric, so we could see all the cells that verified that idea. And this is in just wild-type egg chambers, so we can see SLOBO is expressed, in this case, in a radially symmetric pattern. But we can detect further out another protein called APONTIC, which is more evenly expressed. And this would pretty much always be radially symmetric around the polar cells. So APONTIC is a negative regulator of STAT activity. So it turns down the signaling. So we postulated that if our asymmetric cases were due to some cells not being able to respond to STAT signaling, that if we took APONTIC away, maybe they would get more activation because this negative regulator was gone. So basically what we wanted to do was lower the threshold for STAT activation to see if we would get more radially symmetric patterns. So the question is, does lowering STAT threshold cause changes in the arrangements of activated cells? And in fact, it does. So in the APONTIC mutants, we got much more often this purple category of symmetrical activation about the polar cells than we had seen in our controls. And this was an important experiment because it told us that all the cells in the epithelium were capable to respond to STAT signaling, but some of them just weren't. But so that still left us with a puzzle, which was, why were they not responding? I should mention that we had a similar result when we overexpressed the activator. So that was further evidence that all the cells were able to respond. It wasn't that there was some asymmetric localization of an inhibitor, for example. So our next idea was that maybe the underlying tissue was somehow affecting the activator distribution. So if we kind of zoom in on the very anterior tip of the egg chamber, where the cells are sitting in the epithelium ready to be fated as border cells, we can see that there are the giant germline cells that I mentioned called nerve cells, and that they create small gaps in the tissue. And we could use markers for the edges of the cells to see that there were these gaps in vivo. Although this is a small gap, it's much smaller than the border cell that's outlined nearby. It's a pretty big gap for if you're a diffusible molecule, right? So this seemed like this could be, we could be affecting the distribution of the activator by this tissue geometry. So to test this idea, at first what Lathina looked at was to see what the organization patterns were relative to the underlying tissue. So these are projections down through into the egg chamber, and the red is showing the edges of the nerve cells, and the blue is showing the large germline cell nuclei, and it's schematized here on the side. So whenever we had the polar cells and the border cell clusters with STAT activation sitting right over one nerve cell, we would see this radially symmetric pattern around the polar cells. In contrast, when the polar cells were sitting over a cleft created by two or three germline cells underneath, again, these are projections, we got these gaps in the activation pattern. And that was, these are two different examples, but you can see them summarized here, where the polar cells are gray, and we see gaps in the green cells, which are representing the STAT activation. So what we wanted to do was track unpaired the activator, but we didn't have a way to do that. We tried some tools in vivo, and we haven't yet done that, although I do want to do that still. But we did the next best thing, which was to develop a mathematical model of this distribution of signal. And this was work with the Undergraduate Biology Mathematics Training Program, which was an NSF grant. And Dr. Brad Piercy from Mathematics was the faculty partner in this work. And Anne-Marie Weidman, who was an undergrad at the time but went on to do her master's, was doing the modeling. So we hypothesized, again, that small changes in tissue geometry were changing the shape of the distribution of our activator. And to build the model, we kind of took the epithelial cells and flattened them out, and then created a couple polar cells in the middle that are going to be secreting the signal. We could build domains underneath, either with one or two or three nerve cells, but in some cases we would create a cleft domain. And then we could use a reaction diffusion system to model where unpaired the activator would be in this domain. So this is defined by the rate of signal diffusion in X, Y, and Z, the release rate of the signal, omega, and then the uptake rate of the signal from within to the follicle cells, the epithelial cells. And we estimated these parameters based on some experiments that have been done predominantly in flies to measure distribution of signals in vivo in imaginal disc tissue. So if we flatten out the epithelium again, and our two polar cells are in the center, and this is the bottom side of the epithelium, so this is where they would be perceiving the activator signal, we can define a domain of cells here, and then we can put in the cleft underneath. And then we can run a model for what that would look like over time. And so this simulation is showing a cleft width of 5 microns, which is almost half a cell. And this heat map shows you how much activation there is. So as you go higher on the heat map, you get more activation. So if we look close at this, you can see the two polar cells are here. The cleft is sitting to one side, but the activation is only to one side of the polar cells, even though both of them are releasing unpaired. So in this case, it looks like the activation pattern is on the other side of the cleft that's created by the tissue underneath. In this case, if we let the model run longer, We would eventually fill up the cleft between the cells underneath, and it would get to a high enough level that could influence the activation pattern to that side of the polar cells, as well as we would still have activation to this side of the cleft. So what this told us was that the cleft, the tissue domain underneath, could act first as a sink and then as a source of activating signal, which I thought was a very surprising result. It wasn't intuitive to me that that would be the case. But it is really an interesting idea that I don't think we could have come to without the modeling. So the next step was to create a model in which we had three nurse cells underneath, three germline cells underneath the epithelium, because that was the most common case we saw in vivo. And in this case, Anne-Marie did a parameter sweep where she's changing just the size of one of the domains underneath the epithelium, and the other two are remaining the same. And when she did that set of parameters, what she could show was that we would get all the different patterns of activation that we saw in vivo. So radially symmetric gaps in the pattern are completely asymmetric patterns to one side. So that told us this was sufficient to give us the kind of behaviors we were seeing in terms of cellular activation, that this landscape was playing a role potentially, and that that would explain these patterns. To test this further, we took advantage of Drosophila genetics, and we got a mutant line from Trudy Schupak's lab called Half Pint, which has fewer germline cells. So there's half as many germline cells as normal, and we could show that in those mutants, the gap between the epithelial cells and the germline cells was bigger. So you would expect that could change how the diffusible activator moved through that space. And so Lathina then showed that in that case, 100% of our egg chambers had radially symmetric activation patterns, that the cleft, now that it's further away, wasn't having as big of an influence. And so this is one example of that, where you can see activation of the STAT activity pattern surrounding the polar cells. Anne-Marie then built this into the model as well and could show the same results. So in the half-pint mutants, when she ran the model and did the same kinds of parameter sweeps we saw before, she saw a radially symmetric activation pattern in all those cases. So that supported our mutant analysis in vivo. So I think this is a really exciting result because I think it's unexpected. It basically is telling us that the underlying tissue geometry is non-autonomously affecting the cell as signaling in the adjacent tissue. And so it's depicted here where you have activator that's maybe coming from this source cell. And along the epithelium, you can see different levels of activation potentially could occur just as a function of that landscape. And so I think this has big implications in how we think about development in general and any kinds of extracellular signaling you might think about, because you could always have asymmetries or contours in tissues in a multicellular organism that could act to trap signals or influence their distribution. And as I told you, in our case, high levels of JAK-STAT signaling are required, and you get a different response at low levels. So that modulation of the levels of signaling are important. So I'm just going to take the last bit of time to talk about some other mutant analysis we've been doing in the lab. So I already told you that JAK-STAT signaling induces the modal cell fate. We saw how it was necessary and sufficient because if you have mutants that lose the function, you don't get any migratory cells. And if you have egg chambers that have higher levels of activation, for example, if you have a constitutively activated Janus kinase, you can get additional migratory cells. So we can take advantage of these different phenotypes or different outputs of the signaling pathway to do genetic screening, and that's what the lab has been focused on recently. And so in wild type, this is a whole egg chamber where the border cells have completed their migration. They can be seen here. And Afsoon Sadin in the lab has done a number of different mutant screens where she's looking at possible regulators of JAK-STAT signaling. So she's knocking those down specifically in the border cells to see if they look like these STAT phenotypes that we saw, the STAT mutant phenotypes. So on all the way on the right, you can see an example of what we saw in the previous slide, which were additional migratory cells. This is a knockdown of a phosphatase that's important for dampening the STAT signaling pathway. So you can see lots of additional migratory cells in this case compared to in the wild type control. So she's done some characterization, but this was already known to be a player in the regulator of JAK-STAT signaling. So she's turned her attention now to this case where I can't point out the border cells to you because they're not there anymore. So she was really curious as to why the border cells were no longer being specified in these mutants. And it turns out that this is due to a defect in the alpha snap molecule, which is alpha soluble NSF attachment protein, which is involved in vesicle trafficking. And it's also been implicated in neurotransmitter release, which is where it's been most well studied. So this is the model from neurons. And if you think about neurotransmitter release, you have a synaptic vesicle that is going to come to the cell surface. It's controlled in part by snare proteins that interact with each other, one at the cell surface or one type at the cell surface and one on the vesicle. So those two things can be pulled together basically by those interactions, resulting in release of the neurotransmitter in this case. Here in this part of the diagram is alpha snap, which is the molecule that we were interested in. And the NSF protein, which is an ethylamide-sensitive fusion protein. These two molecules together, as far as we know, are important for resetting the vesicle trafficking components so that you can go through another round of vesicle fusion. So if you don't have these, you basically block later steps in the vesicle fusion system. So what Afsoon has shown now is that if she knocks down this alpha snap RNA in the polar cells, we get the phenotype I showed you earlier with no migratory cells. If she knocks it down in the modal border cells, we have normal cellular development. So it's not doing anything super important in those cells. It doesn't seem to have an effect there. She did similar screens looking at a lot of different vesicle trafficking proteins, including a bunch of syntaxins and other related factors. She got similar results with syntaxin A, where we didn't see any border cells or modal cells, but most of the other ones did not have a strong effect in this case. So we think that AlphaSnap may be working with syntaxin A to give this kind of phenotype. I told you at the beginning that she was looking for modulators of JAK-STAT signaling, and she has shown, that's not shown here, but she's shown that there's genetic interactions with alpha-SNAP and mutant alleles of STAT. And in this experiment, this was kind of cool because she could show that in her mutants where we have lost alpha-SNAP or high levels of alpha-SNAP, she could overexpress the activator unpaired just in the polar cells and restore to 80% the number of modal the number of egg chambers that had modal cells faded again. So we think that this alpha-SNAP molecule is doing something very specific for the STAT pathway because we can get that rescue effect. So our working model is that unpaired in vesicles requires alpha-SNAP to be released or to go through a subsequent rounds of release. And that's important for regulating the amount of activator molecule in the extracellular space, which is required for specifying the border cells. So in summary, we've looked at a number of different layers of regulation that coordinate signaling between cells. We focused in the anterior part of the egg chamber epithelium and looked at interactions between the germline and the soma. And we saw how trafficking regulation in the polar cells likely influences the amount of activator released. And this could have similar functions in the JAK-STAT pathway in humans. We looked at how architectural influences of the neighboring tissue maybe can control the levels of the activator nearby cells and that might influence how much they respond. And I haven't talked about it so much today, but we've also done molecular regulation to understand downstream components of the JAK-STAT signaling pathway and to see what regulators are working within the border cells to regulate the transcription and then the modal cell properties that those cells have. So I just want to thank the people who did the work. Lathina Manning did all the imaging of the upright patterns of activation. And Anne-Marie Weidman and Brad Piercy were our math collaborators who did the modeling for us. Afsoon Sidine did all of the work with Alpha Snap. And we have a number of other collaborators who are listed here who work in the lab or who have helped us with stocks and reagents or imaging. And we have funding from NSF, and we've had funding from the March of Dimes as well as Meyerhoff for this project. And I'm happy to take any questions. Thanks. Yeah.
Michelle, the AlphaSnap result suggests that vesicle fusion can also regulate the timing of signaling, right? And that if those, akin to synaptic vesicles, that the regulation of stat secretion could be controlled by regulating vesicle fusion. And is there any idea that might be happening in that case?
Yeah, it's a really good question. So we don't know if AlphaSnap is controlling the timing. We know that it's on in most cells. It's required in most cells most of the time. But I think that it's at a higher level at the times when you would get release of unpaired the activator. But in the experiments that I showed you, we were mostly controlling for time, so we didn't look that early. But I am encouraged that the other cell surface molecules are not affected by that, the alpha snap knockdown. So I think it is doing something specific potentially for the timing or the pathway in particular. That's something we should look more into. Rachel.
So I have two questions that are somewhat related. The first one is, do you see a lot of variability in the number of cells that are specified as border cells? Because the second question is, it would be annoying for a fly embryo to have such a high level of randomness in terms of its environment and these gaps.
Right. Right.
So how does it deal with it?
Right. So it's a great question. So Rachel's asking if there's variability in the number of border cells that are specified. It's actually remarkably consistent. So Lithena, we did a lot of counts to demonstrate that it's almost always 6. It can vary, and it'll vary a little bit by genotype, but it's actually very consistent. And we know initially about 12 cells respond to STAT signaling and turn it on at first. So there's a dampening effect that's going on. There's some kind of auto-feedback, but we don't know how it counts. We started how it counts how many cells it has. That number of cells is required to allow the polar cells to be moved, because we know if you have fewer cells, that doesn't work anymore. So we don't understand how the counting works, but it is absolutely specific.
So in your mathematical modeling, you said that these gaps could serve as like a later region where additional cells could be then recruited as border cells, but do you see that in, like, is the timing of specification off by a few minutes, or?
Right, so this is happening over hours. So Rachel's question is, do we ever see the sort of model, do we see support for the model where the clefts fill up with an activator and then we see different patterns of activation? And it seems like, I think that may be happening, but it's happening earlier. But I think it does explain some of the really crazy patterns we saw, that if it's happening earlier and there's development proceeding and things are shifting around, we don't see a great lineup always with the clefts between cells anymore. But I think it still is a reasonable model that it could be helping to control the number if there's not enough. My guess is that maybe the organization of the tissue is influencing where the cells want to be specified so that they can be ready to dive into that tissue, right? So they're better off in their own worldview to be able to go where there's not any cells, right? So if you have a gap between the cells, that's sort of a better place to be specified than if you're specified over nurse cells where you have to go around them to keep going. Does that make sense? But we don't know about the number.
So I was actually thinking connecting the two stories that you told us. So first story sort of says that you need maybe a certain concentration of unpaired, which collects in that trough.
Right.
And the second story says that, you know, the first signaling may not be enough. You know,
right.
Is it quantity or is it timing that they need to see?
It's a good question. I don't think we have a good answer. We're going to have to tag the molecule. That's what we're trying to do now. So Sunny's here. He's working on making a dendrite for that. But I think initially the trough between cells, it's losing the signals being lost to that at first. And then it pulls up enough that you get the specification based on the timing mostly, because this is, again, happening over hours. We know unpaired's released earlier than we see any of the activation of STAT in the nearby cells.
So the apical versus basal secretion then totally changes the landscape that a signal is going to experience, right? And so, first of all, have you tried to manipulate and try to do apical secretion of unpaired? And are there situations where you think that apical versus basal secretion is actually taking advantage of the landscape to change
the shape? Yeah, it's a good question. So in this tissue, apical is towards the nerve cells. And Stefano Selli's lab has shown that RNA for unpaired is localized to that side. So it seems to be preferentially made and secreted to that side. I don't think that we would see an effect on the, I don't know how we could localize it to the basal side, but it would be interesting. But presumably there's a lot more extracellular matrix that would sort of block its movement in that space. So I think it would be hard to interpret, maybe. It is a glycoprotein, so there's other things that are helping traffic it.
Any other questions? Let's thank our speaker.
All right, thank you.
Going forward. If anybody else is in the back that wants to find a seat, I suggest not sitting over on this side because you cannot see a thing. That'll help lease my vision. So it's my pleasure now to have Dr. Jeffrey Gross, professor of ophthalmology and developmental biology. He's an E. Ronald Salvetti chair in ophthalmological research, director of the Lewis J. Fox Center for Vision Restoration, University of Pittsburgh School of Medicine. He's a returning alumnus. He received his BS in biology in 1996 from UMBC, and he worked under the direction of Dr. Phyllis Robinson, who takes all credit for his success. No, I'm just kidding. She did tell us the story that when he started in your lab, right, early on, and he did everything at his eye level. So she had some tough time getting everything back down off the shelves later on. So anyway, without further ado, we'll bring him up on stage.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you. It's really fun to be back and see a lot of familiar faces and a lot of new faces and a lot of new buildings. And campus has changed a lot in 20 years. I feel like I should tell some funny joke about Phyllis or story, but she's taking me out to dinner, so I don't want to get stranded in the Inner Harbor. I haven't been here in a long time, and I might not remember how to get home. And I don't want to call my mom at this age. It would be a little embarrassing. So yeah, so we're going to switch gears a little bit. And my lab, for quite a while now, we've been interested in eye development, largely just really early development of the eye, the retina, the optic cup. And more recently, so I moved to Pittsburgh about a year and a half ago, we've been getting more and more interested in regeneration and using zebrafish. So zebrafish have a really tremendous ability to regenerate many of their organs, and particularly their eye. So I'm going to tell you a kind of a new story that we've been developing over the last couple of years. So using zebrafish in eye research, I mean, many of you, or hopefully all of you, know about using zebrafish from Rachel Brewster's work, neural tube, you know, really great model for early development, in vivo imaging, you know, many of these techniques. And particularly for the eye, it has many, many attributes, and that's why we like to use it. The most important is that it's morphologically similar to the human eye. So if you're going to model development, model disease, or start to model regeneration, you want to make sure you have the right tissues and that they're doing the right thing. So this, you're going to see a lot of sections in my talk that look something like this, although many times they'll be stained for immunohistochemistry, but this is just a cross-section through the larval zebrafish eye. It's in structure, it's very, very similar to your eye. So you've got an anterior at the front, cornea and lens, and the light is focused through these onto the retina. So the zebrafish retina is from here to here. You've got photoreceptors in the back, rods and cones. You've got this retinal pigmented epithelium, so this is the pigmented layer at the back of the eye. And then you've got all of these inner neurons in the center of the retina that then lead to the ganglion cell layers in the innermost part of the retina that send their axons to the optic nerve and then back to the brain. And that's how visual space is mapped. So our eye looks very, very similar to this. I mean, this is a larval eye. We have a vitreous. We have some minor differences. There's, in zebrafish, these continually proliferative areas at the margins of the retina called the marginal zones or germinal zones. We actually, some recent results suggest that mammals might have these, but up until a month or so ago, people didn't think there was anything like this in the mammalian eye. But by and large, this is really what our eye looks like as well. So then all of these techniques, I mean, it's almost embarrassing to highlight these after a Drosophila genetics talk, but for zebrafish, this is sort of a big deal, you know, being able to do Gal4, UAS, Cre-Lox, make knock-ins, knockouts, particularly with CRISPRs. This has become really nice to just take out loci cleanly and also try to put tags in back in the endogenous locus and things like this. For genetics, I think this is hugely important, and it's something when I was a postdoc that we really took advantage of by working with Nancy Hopkins, just the ability in a vertebrate to kind of rapidly screen through many, many thousands of embryos and find those that model, you know, a particular disease you're interested in, a developmental process, something like this. You can do this in mouse. It's obviously a lot more expensive and takes a little bit more time, and I think that's a nice part about zebrafish for vertebrate genetics. The in vivo imaging is really spectacular to image many aspects of development. Ongoing interest in our lab has been optic cup development, so really how the early eye forms. And this is something that's extremely difficult to do in a mouse because it's happening very early. So doing the in utero imaging is quite difficult. There's a couple labs in the world that can do it. But in fish, you just slap them down on the microscope and watch it go. And it seems like many of the principles that are learned by that, again, have direct relevance to the human eye. Embryology, I trained in a sea urchin development lab, so embryology is kind of near and dear to my heart, that you can move cells around and ask sort of these autonomous, non-autonomous questions that Michelle was talking about towards the end of her talk. It's kind of easy to do this both through genetics, but also embryologically. What we're sort of moving into and what I want to talk about today is more in this regenerative side. So, as I said, zebrafish have been used for quite a while now to look at heart regeneration, fin regeneration, pigment cell regeneration, all those different things. And in the retina, particularly, they have this remarkable ability that they can recover from any injury. So you can stick a needle in their eye. You can put them under constant light for a week and kill all the photoreceptors. You can genetically ablate different cell types, and they'll always regenerate those. And they do so through the activity of the glial cells in the retina called the Müller glia. So basically these Müller glia end up, normally they're there to support photoreceptors, they're there to support the retina, they provide some structural integrity. But what happens when there's an injury, they perceive that injury, they figure out what cells are missing, they start to de-differentiate and generate what are called Müller glia progenitor cells. So they sort of have this stem cell-like ability. They can then churn off these Müller glia progenitor cells and regenerate the cells that have been lost to the injury. So this is really remarkable. What happens in our eye, if I stick a needle in your eye, that same process starts. These Müller glia get activated. They start to react. On rare occasions, they'll proliferate. But when they do proliferate, they never generate these progenitor cells to respond to injury. That proliferation can actually be pathogenic, and it causes even more problems to the eye. So one question in the lab is why fish can regenerate, not just our lab, but many labs, why fish can regenerate and why the Müller glia have this remarkable ability and why we don't. Similarly, as I said, there's this progenitor cell zone at the periphery of the retina that contains stem cells. So a fish eye, a frog eye, you know, many, many animals will continue to grow, and it's from these areas where new neurons come. So this is sort of by way of background, something we're interested in. And as I'll tell you, what we've started to get interested in is this pigmented layer at the back of the eye and whether those will regenerate. So all of the work I'm going to talk about is the work of a grad student in my lab who received his PhD on Monday, Nick Hanneweis. So I'm really proud. This is kind of a fun project that we weren't interested in regeneration. Nick's dad's an ophthalmologist, and when he came to the lab, actually it's terrifying to have a student whose father's an ophthalmologist, who also retired. This is when I was in Austin, retired to Austin, Texas, and he used to come to my genetics lectures every day and sit in the back and ask questions. And it actually, you know, for tenure and promotion, I never cared when my peers were there that I was going to say something stupid, but when one of my students' parents was there, it really terrified me that I was going to embarrass myself and then no longer be able to mentor him. But anyway, Nick came to the lab and he sort of didn't want to work on the development side, and he was really interested in thinking about regeneration, and he wanted to try to develop a glaucoma model and a macular degeneration model. And we sort of went down these two paths, and the glaucoma, we actually found out you really can't give zebrafish glaucoma. This is where your ganglion cells die because of a buildup of pressure, because they regenerate them so quickly. So you can't give them the disease because they fix it before you can actually study the disease process. But luckily, at least for us, Nick was able to develop sort of a macular degeneration model. So this is the sort of cartoon version of age-related macular degeneration. And what happens in AMD, there's sort of a natural aging process where basically these pigmented epithelial cells at the back of your eye, they're constantly phagocytosing off the tips of the photoreceptors, and they're degrading material from those. They're doing many, many other things, but this is one component of that process. And as they get older, they're unable to do this as well. And some of these lipids and byproducts start to build up below the RPE and against what's called Bruch's membrane at the back of the eye. And this is a basement membrane that separates the blood supply from the retina. So this material starts to build up. It's called drusen. And as it builds up, it starts to create inflammation, an immune response, and slowly poison these pigmented epithelial cells. And I think so we have a cartoon of that here. So you've got your RPE and you've got your photoreceptors. And this is actually a subtype of AMD called geographic atrophy. So this is where about 85, 90% of cases of macular degeneration are this dry form, and then there's a wet form where the vasculature starts to invade. That's different than this. That's the only one that's actually treatable. So there's different compounds that can at least slow down the invasion of that vasculature. Whereas this geographic version, this drusen version, it's really irreversible, and there's no therapies for it. So what happens is you start to, as this drusen builds up behind the RPE, a subset of RPE cells start to get sick. That's not a big deal. They die. The RPE is able to sort of spread out and continue to support the underlying photoreceptors. But now each individual pigmented epithelial cell has to support more photoreceptors. So slowly and slowly and slowly, they continue to get sick, die, and then all the photoreceptors are going to go with them. And this is what happens during AMD. So this would be kind of a cartoon version of what it would look like to you if you had AMD. So at the beginning, you're starting to lose, and you're losing the vision in your central area, the fovea. So that's why it's so devastating. In fact, you'll see a lot of older people just naturally start to look more out of the periphery of their eye. And that's because this is a natural process of aging. But then when it becomes pathogenic, you get this really severe degeneration of the retina and total blindness that many people are not very functional because they've lost that high acuity vision. And this is what's called a fundus photograph. So this is a photograph of the back of the eye. And you can see these sort of yellow spots. This is drusen, and this is drusen building up in that fovea. So the point is there's no effective therapy. So what Nick set out to do is to learn what was available, sort of what's out there about RPE regeneration, and start to see if he could develop a model for this so we could understand it. So what he found was not that much. What's known in the literature is that, much like I showed in that cartoon, if you have a small injury, and this can be any sort of injury, really it's not that big of a deal because the surrounding cells, so if there was an injury here, these cells surrounding that area can just expand a little bit. These RPE cells have a remarkable ability to spread out. So they can spread out and they can take care of the photoreceptors underneath them. When you have a larger injury, they're no longer able to do that because they can't support that large area. And then in some cases, they start to proliferate. And proliferation you would think would be good, so they're starting to divide, maybe they'll generate new RPE cells. In the rare cases where that happens, it often is an over-proliferative event, and those RPE cells don't fill in the gap. They actually cause more pathology, so it's a condition called PVR, proliferative vitreoretinopathy, and this is really devastating because it actually causes even more damage. It can cause retinal detachments and lots of retinal injuries. So there's no sort of positive injury response to a severe injury like what would be happening in macular degeneration. So Nick thought, okay, the zebrafish have this remarkable regenerative ability. We know the Müller glia can fix a lot of or really all retinal damage. We've got these stem cells out at the periphery, but we don't know much about the RPE. So simple question, can the zebrafish RPE regenerate? And he asked me this during his rotation, and as I say to most questions the students ask, I don't know, go figure it out. So Nick really developed his thesis project around this. I think he's come up with something really cool. So the first thing we did was, in collaboration with a friend of mine, Brian Link, at the Medical College of Wisconsin, Brian provided us with a promoter for a gene called RPE65. And this basically expresses a protein in mature RPE. And he had fused a nitroreductase gene tagged with GFP to this. Nitroreductase is a protein that's normally harmless. So you can sort of see a green RPE here at the back of the eye. These are the photoreceptors. This is the inner retina. So it's doing nothing. These cells are perfectly normal. But when you add a compound called metronidazole, nitroreductase turns this into a potent DNA cross-linking agent that causes apoptosis. So it provides us with a really nice and quick way to ablate regions of the central RPE, so the mature RPE, about this central two-thirds. We can kill these cells and then look at the response. And we can control when we do this, how we do this. We can do it in smaller amounts by playing with the promoter, doing DNA injections and things. So it gives us a really nice model to create injuries and then see what happens. So the first thing Nick did was really carefully characterize this system. And what he saw was that the injury response is extremely rapid. So I'll use a lot of these abbreviations, either HPI or DPI. So HPI is hours post-injury, and DPI is days post-injury. So within 3 hours post-injury, if he stains, and these are really small, but hopefully you can see, if he stains for a marker for tunnel for apoptosis, you see these red cells appearing in the RPE. So just after a couple of hours of metronidazole exposure, the RPE starts to die. And then not even a day after that, you see this massive death in the photoreceptor layer as well. And then out, this is just showing at 24 hours, you're losing lots and lots of photoreceptors at this point, and the morphology of the photoreceptor layer is also really being compromised. So for a number of reasons, we're fairly sure the metronidazole is specifically killing the RPE cells, and this is not a result of sort of leaky expression of the nitroreductase. But in a way, it doesn't matter either. All we're trying to do here is kill the RPE and create a model through which we can look at whether it regenerates. When he quantifies these data, you see this sort of nice kinetics of apoptosis that seems to peak at about 24 hours and go down. And the apoptosis in the photoreceptor layer, this is called the outer nuclear layer of the retina, really trails that nicely, and you get a peak and down. So it's a very rapid response and a very nice response for us in the sense that we can now kill the RPE and see what happens. If we look by TEM, just to really highlight this, this is an 8-day-old larval, so 3 days post-injury. So we do a lot of the injuries at 5 days. So 8 days is the control, 3 days is the injury. You know, normally by EM, you see this really nice pigmented layer shown here in high magnification. These are melanosomes, so the organelles which contain that dark black pigment in the RPE. There's a membrane at the back here, as I said, called Bruch's membrane, and then this is the vasculature. These are the photoreceptor outer segments in a wild type. In the ablated one, you really can't make out much of anything. You can get a few, perhaps, melanosomes that are being degraded. You have these large inclusions. The photoreceptors are really disorganized. So again, the RPE is being ablated here, and it's affecting the photoreceptors underneath. So now he can ask the question. He's got a model that he can kill the RPE. What happens to it? Can it regenerate? Luckily, it can. So what he found, and hopefully with the lights you can see this, but what it appears to be is he's using two markers here. One is an antibody for a protein called ZPR2, and this marks the immature RPE in red. And then he's just using the transgene itself, which is going to turn back on. which marks a more mature RP. And what you see is out at this periphery, you start to see red, and you kind of see it moving in towards the center. So the first point is, yes, they regenerate, that by about 2 weeks, you've actually got a really nice functional RPE layer here. But it looks like that regeneration is happening from this outward direction in. So we call it peripheral to central. By EM, these are the recovered ones, so 14 days post-injury, which is 19 days of development. Again, a normal eye here, you've got the RPE, you've got these rod and cone outer segments, which have now segregated into two layers. When you look at the regenerated RPE, it looks really good. It's thicker than normal, and it's more highly pigmented than normal. We don't know what this means yet, but it's very reproducible. But it appears to be perfectly fine. What I'm not showing you is when we do the ablations, we actually lose that Brooks membrane as well. We start to get holes in it. So we actually think that that type of damage precedes the vasculature coming in. It's kind of a side story of this project that I'm not going to talk about. But what's here is really nice is we see a recovery of that Brooks membrane. So this is a really good functional RPE. We've done visual tests on these animals, so we can see that they go blind very early when we do this, that they recover their vision. We've done what's called OCT imaging, so we can do longitudinal imaging of the same animal over time. And we also see that sort of it appears that that regeneration is coming from this periphery in. So this is exciting that now we know they regenerate and we can try to figure out how. And that's really the big question. What's the mechanism underlying this response? I'm going to show a few of these model cartoons, so I'll just introduce it now. Basically, you've got this RPE65 ablation cassette in the central two-thirds. You kill this RPE, and then what it appears like is that you kind of get this recovery coming in towards the center that after about 2 weeks, you get functional recovery. Yeah, and this is just, again, showing you that with the immuno. So Nick has done a whole series of experiments, and I'm not going to go through them ad nauseum here, but just kind of show you a couple of the highlights. The first thing he did was just expose animals to BRDU. So BRDU is an analog that incorporates into proliferating DNA. So what he can do is identify cells that are proliferating during the period of induction. So what he did was he exposed ablated embryos to BRDU at different time points, either after injury or allowed chase periods. And what he sees is you get a lot of proliferation of the retina. So this is the peripheral region of the retina that's always proliferating. I should tell you this is the lens, so that's always proliferating. But what he sees are these cells very quickly after injury. Hopefully you can see this is a black line here. And if he looks at these at high mag, this is a cell that's proliferating in that non-ablated RPE area. And when he looks at 1 to 2 days, you're seeing a few more of these in the high mag, hopefully you can see it here, that are kind of moving, I shouldn't say moving into that area, they're more central than they were the day before. Continuing this out 2 to 3, 3 to 4 days, again, you get more of these proliferative cells. And what you actually notice too is that you're starting to get some GFP behind them as well. That's suggesting that these cells, not only as they're proliferating, but they're generating some new RPE and the transgene turning on here. And this is a whole series of those. And if he looks, the kinetics of this seems to be by about 3 to 4 days after injury, you get a peak of this proliferation in the RPE that dies out after about a week. And full recovery seems to take about 2 weeks. So looking at this a different way, if he takes the eye out and flips it so you can look at the back, this is what a normal eye looks like. So it's nice and green because it has the transgene. You occasionally get a proliferative cell. This is actually probably a vasculature cell that didn't get peeled off. We now do this with different markers. When he looks at the ablated ones, he sees this whole ring of proliferation. I was really looking at the whole eye around the central injury site. When you zoom in, what's kind of exciting is you see these proliferative cells are becoming pigmented. So hopefully you can see this, but surrounding it, it has this dark melanin telling us that these proliferative cells actually are differentiating into RPE as well. And that kind of building on the model, he starts to see this proliferation out at the periphery that are turning into RPE over time. So we think it's that the uninjured region of pigmented epithelial cells, what's left is what's able to regenerate this tissue. So now he did a slightly different experiment. He treated with BRDU and then ablated waited a few days and he added a different analog. So now he can do double labeling and basically see where these early proliferating cells end up. So see where these guys end up, but also see if there's a subset of them that keep proliferating. You know, perhaps much like the Müller glia, which will continue to churn off these stem cells, maybe after injury, a subset of these become stem cell-like, or at least progenitor cell-like, that they can churn off a few more of these cells. And when he does that, he indeed sees both of those things. So you have a couple of these red cells. So these are the BRDU positive cells that were labeled early, and those are pigmented. So this tells us that after ablation at this early time point, these cells do give rise to new RPE. But then he sees a very small subset of cells that are double positive, meaning that they were proliferating at this phase and they continue to proliferate at this phase 3 days later. There's one of those right here. Suggesting that there's a subset of these that really do continue to proliferate over several days. Again, showing more at high magnification as well here, and if he does a much longer chase, he gets lots of these BRDU positive cells that are turning into RPE, telling us that it is really this early population that's regenerating the RPE. He did a lot of TEM, and he saw that there are these RPE cells. So this is a cell that's outlined right here from about, this obviously isn't the same animal, but it's about from the central region. And he sees these really long cells, extensions. So they're very thin at the beginning, and they seem to extend into the injury site. So this is about the edge of the injury site into this central part. And these things are probably 20 microns or so in length on average. This one, I guess we picked the exception, this one's probably about 40 microns in length, but they extend into this area and you can see they're starting to become pigmented as well. And they have some debris in them, so they also possibly function in clearing it. It's shown here a little bit well. So here's some of the debris. These cells form tight junctions, so they're really starting to mature into normal RPE cells. What we've sort of done here and what we're excited about is, first, we think we've created a model for AMD, so we can kill the RPE, we see the photoreceptors die, but more importantly, we can study the process of regeneration. And we've shown, this is really the first demonstration, that the RPE, like the retina, like the heart, like the kidney, like many other tissues in zebrafish, on one hand this isn't surprising, but on the other it's kind of exciting, that they do regenerate, because it now allows us to start to think about how this happens. So both the cell biology and the critical experiment that we're doing now is genetic fate mapping. So all of these experiments I've done so far are sort of suggestive that it's this population of cells that go in and regenerate the RPE. So now we're really carefully going in and using a variety. I think Nick's done this in 6 or 7 different ways, just to kind of hedge his bets, where he can flip different constructs out, change color, and track the fates of those cells over days to really ensure that it's the RPE, not these Müller glia. So we have no evidence that they give rise to the new RPE, not any other cell invading from the outside. So he's doing those fate mapping experiments, and the very preliminary results support that it's these RPE cells. And then when we do that, we can really start to do some cool experiments. So I think, in some ways this is a work in progress, but it's something that we're really excited about, because we know nothing about this process, and there's really no good therapy to restore RPE. People are doing stem cell injections. It's just, putting a bunch of stem cells in the back of somebody's eye that turn into RPE is not if you talk to any, I'm now in an ophthalmology department, you talk to any ophthalmologist, they're kind of shaking their head that they think this is a really bad idea. Even if these do work, how they integrate with those photoreceptors underneath them is really unknown. So we kind of have a model where we can start to look at this. And we're trying to develop ways now to do some single cell sequencing, so we can sequence some of these cells at different phases of the regenerative response and see what they're expressing. And that, I think, might be the most exciting part of this from a therapeutic standpoint, because we might be able to identify pathways or compounds or things that we could then start to work in a mammalian system to see if we can tweak regeneration a little bit by manipulating one of these pathways. And then the other thing that Nick's discovered, and in the regeneration world, this isn't really surprising, but the immune response seems to be involved in regeneration. It's a little bit different. It seems like the immune response is required for this regenerative response to happen, whereas, again, in our eye, that immune response actually contributes to the pathology, because it causes the cells to get inflamed and die as well. But this is sort of common in a lot of regenerative contexts where the immune response really seems to contribute to that. So this is our working model that we think it's these proliferative cells out at the periphery that are giving rise to the rest of the regenerated RPE. So again, this has all been the thesis work of one of the students, Nick Hanevice, who's really, I think, done an amazing job. He's done a couple of other things. He actually found an NSF mutant, so I was kind of curious about the SNAP data on a different pigmentation project. We had some help from Brian Link at the Medical College of Wisconsin, who provided some transgenic lines. And then we have a grant from a Macular Degeneration Foundation that's really helped get this project going, that now I think it's to the point where we can do some of the cool experiments and figure out how this works. And then, you know, one last thanks since I'm up here. I mean, I never would have gotten started in this business if it weren't for Phyllis. You know, I was a random advisee assigned to her, and I don't know if I caught her on a good day or a bad day, but you know, she didn't balk when she asked me what I wanted to do with my life, and and didn't just let me go. She sort of gave me a job and got me started. And as I was joking with the students earlier today, I think I can still make tissue culture medium from scratch. I can make every mini prep buffer from scratch. And I could take anyone in a challenge because she trained me very well to do that. So I'm willing to bet a beer that I can beat any of your current students in doing that. But really, it's fun to be back. And Phyllis, I would not have ever gotten involved in science if it wasn't for you. So I'm grateful. Thank you. And I'm happy to take any questions.
So
you're not allowed to ask questions.
What happens to the photoreceptors in your when your RPE regenerates?
Yeah. So great question. What happens to the photoreceptors? They regenerate really quickly, but they're regenerating from these Müller glial cells. So the Müller glial are doing exactly what they're supposed to do. When we kill the RPE, photoreceptors die. They come back with the same kinetics as they would if we ablated them with light, if we ablated them genetically and left the RPE fine. And they actually integrate. One of the things we've been looking at is the RPE forms these apical processes that surround the photoreceptors. They integrate perfectly well with the new RPE, and everything seems to be functional. They actually recover visual function much quicker than we can detect changes in the anatomy of looking at the tissue. So I think they only need a few photoreceptors to respond to light. Yes?
Does the zebrafish actually develop the drusen bodies? And if so, is there progress? Does it have a process for denaturing these protein clusters?
Mm-hmm. So the question is, does the zebrafish develop the drusen that I talked about, these sort of lipid compounds? They do over time. So we've done some aging studies where we've looked at fish over 1 year, 1.5 years, 2 years, and you definitely see those buildups at the back of the eye. But I think what's interesting, and it sort of in hindsight, this should have been obvious to us, we don't think it matters, because if it's actually killing the pigmented cell underneath, it's just regenerating. So they're not clearing them, but they're probably not having the same pathology that they are in a human. Because the RPE is able to regenerate itself. Even if the photoreceptor dies, the photoreceptor is able to regenerate from the Müller glia as well. So we see the buildup. We haven't looked carefully, but we certainly see the buildup, but we don't think the pathology is the same just because of the unique regenerative capacity of the animal.
But you don't see the zebrafish trying to cleanse or clear the drusen bodies that have developed?
No, certainly out to, I think the oldest fish we looked at was maybe 2¾ years of age, and it had sort of a large buildup, but the fish was swimming and feeding and perfectly fine in the tank. Yeah. Sure.
So do you think the cells are migrating in to regenerate? Do you think the cells are migrating in to regenerate sort of as a sheet, or do you think they're individual cells that are proliferating?
And so I took out the lineage cartoon, but there are a couple different ways you could do this. You could have a proliferative population that kind of tractors and pushes everybody else in. You could have spotty cells that are doing this. We think it's that these peripheral ones, and if you think about it in three dimensions that are ring, they're dividing and the newly generated cells appear to be migrating. And we've got a lot of EM images that are really suggestive of that, but they're kind of meaningless until we do the lineage tracking. Doing it in vivo is going to be pretty hard for us. Because of the pigmentation. So that we lose some of the transgenes that way, and we try to do it. But it, everything is suggestive that they're kind of being generated and they're slowly migrating in, and they're getting some help because you're pushing more and more in. But the leaders are definitely, they're always stretched out. They're always pulled into the direction of the injury, suggestive of some kind of migration. And they're always correlating with where that Bruch's membrane at the back of the eye, the basement membrane, they stop at the area where that's broken every time. So it seems like they're probably using that to migrate as well, but all this is hand waving without some firm tracking data.
So do you think there's a chemoattractant, or is it sensing tension, or what? Do you have a sense of what is forcing them to move in that direction?
We think it's probably some sort of attractant to the, and this is really speculative, but probably to the Bruch's membrane, that's known particularly in the human origins. It's known, it's thought that when they detach, so when you have this really severe pathology, when they lose connection to the Bruch's membrane, it's obviously inhibiting them from proliferating. And we think it's probably doing the similar, but I guess opposite here, that it's sort of drawing them into that site, and as it's regenerating, sort of at the leading edge, it's pulling, directing the cells into the injury. But again, we've got to do the imaging that all of this is hand waving until we do that.
So are the RPE cells that are on the margins, do you think that they're taking on a sort of stem cell-like identity? And what is the proximal signal? I mean, you mentioned that the immune system is moving in, but is it necessarily interacting with the cells right at the margin of the wound, or is it loss of adhesion, or what do you think?
Yeah, these are all great questions, and this is really what we want to get at with, particularly with the signaling, right? That maybe there are two subsets of cells. There are sort of the workers that are going in to regenerate, and the queen bees that are telling those cells and generating more of them. It looks like the immune response is necessary, that if we've only done this sort of crudely, but if we inhibit it, we really lose the regeneration. So we give them different steroids, things like this, that'll inhibit it. We don't know what the signal is for the Müller glia. There's some really old experiments that if you inhibit phagocytosis, so the Müller glia also serve to sort of clear some of that debris. If you inhibit that process, they don't undergo regeneration. It looks like these RPE cells at the tip leading into the site are also clearing that, in addition to the immune cells. We see, we've got a really sort of a serendipitous movie that Nick took. We just see, you know, these pigment cells streaming out of the eye, and they appear to be going to the thymus, that we're not immunologists by far. And it looks like these are, you know, we think these are macrophages, so we're sort of doing some imaging with different transgenics to see if that's what's happening. So those are clearing some of the cells. Are they then sending a signal to the existing RPE to tell it to proliferate? Is it that existing RPE is also eating some of this debris and that's the signal? We just don't know, but we have ways now we can start to test that by tweaking the injury and also tweaking the immune response and tweaking the cells around it. So those are all the experiments we're sort of starting or planning to do, but we don't have any firm answers yet. Thank you.
Now let's thank our speaker.
Now for our keynote speaker. Dr. Ruth Lehrman is an investigator at the Howard Hughes Medical Institute and Lauren Isaac Perlmutter Professor of Cell Biology at NYU School of Medicine. She directs the Skirball Institute and the Helen and Martin Kimmel Center for Stem Cell Biology, and is the chair of the Department of Cell Biology at NYU School of Medicine. She's also a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the National Academy of Sciences, and she was a 2011 recipient of the Conklin Medal of the Society of Developmental Biology, was elected a member of EMBO in 2012. And I was really excited when I saw the card came out when we said save the date, because talk was going to be about gremlins. But it turned out that was a typo and it was really germlines. So her research focuses on germlines, and the only cells in the body that are able to give rise to a new generation. So we'll get her up on stage here in a moment. And you can tell I study electrochemistry because it's all about current, is all about rate, and the rate of change of temperature in this room is just not high enough. So, but the absolute is.
Good. Thank you very much.
Well,
nice.
So
whoops. Thank you so much for the, maybe I'll warm up while I'm jumping around here. Thank you so much for the invitation. It's really great. It's particularly nice to be invited sort of in connection with Michelle, who was my first graduate student when I moved from MIT to NYU. And she set such a high bar for everyone. And also in my lab, she really tried to push life observation of germ cell migration, and she's continued to doing that, and that was really transformative for us. So I'm also going to tell you something about the germs line, but more about the functioning of the germ cells. Whoops, this probably does not work. So did you have something else? How I can forward, or maybe then we should do the, take the other one, because mine seems not to work. Works. So I don't have to. You already got an introduction into the germline. What's fascinating to us is sort of the immortality of the germline, and obviously these are the only cells in the body that are able to regenerate themselves and give rise to a whole new organism. And so we would like to understand what makes sperm and egg so special, and also when germ cells are set aside, how do they differentiate from the somatic cells that make the whole rest of the embryo and the adult. So we are particularly interested in two aspects of germline development. One is RNA regulation and the protection of the stability of the genome, and the other is mitochondrial inheritance, because all the mitochondria are inherited only through the oocyte, and so this is true for flies and this is true for mammals, and we don't actually understand exactly how mitochondria, for example, are selected, and I will tell you something about the function of mitochondria. RNA regulation will be the first part of my talk, and what's really quite striking about the germline, and that's pretty general, is that there is no master transcriptional regulator which determines germline. There is no MyoD for the germline, and instead it is RNA regulation that is the common theme, and the proteins which are conserved between all germlines are actually RNA binding proteins. And so in the first part I'm going to tell you something about RNA binding proteins and how RNAs are organized in RNA granules. In the second part I'm going to tell you something about mitochondria. And so So talking about RNA granules, these RNA granules are really widespread, and some of you may know that there are sort of two modes of how germ cells are formed. They can either form by germplasm, which is maternally provided, and then localized in either in the egg cell, like here in the fly, or in Xenopus, at the vegetal pole. And then taken up into the germ cells, or here in the mouse, where germ cells are induced by induction between the extraembryonic ectoderm and the embryo proper, we also see this electron-dense material which connects between oocytes, and in all of these cases, what's interesting is there's this, you know, there's this electron-dense particles, and they're always associated closely with mitochondria. And so we study this in the germline, and you also familiarity with the process of germline development, and so we're interested in how RNA are regulated in the early embryo, and I'll tell you about that. And we are also interested in how the germline soma dichotomy is established, in particular these RNAs which are inherited, which are deposited
either mother, will in the early embryo provide everything that the early embryo in its germ cells needs for the germ cells to migrate to the somatic part of the gonad. And you can see here the red staining is actually a staining for active transcription, which only occurs in the soma and does not occur in the germline. Germ cell migration is a process which we study since Denise was in the lab. Now technology is a little better with light sheet microscopy, but I'm not going to tell you anything about it. And then I want to tell you a little bit about stem cell differentiation in the germline. And so I'm going to start with RNA regulation. So the organization of the germ plasm in the fly starts off with this RNA being highly concentrated at the posterior pole, and then you see the RNA being uniformly distributed throughout the embryo. Only the localized RNA is translated, while the unlocalized RNA is translationally repressed. And if we look more closely into this region, there are these granules, which are called germ granules, which are membraneless organelles, which are also share a lot of resemblance to pea bodies or stress granules, which are found in any other cell, depending on the consequence, on the conditions. And so what we know about this germplasm assembly is kind of interesting, and that is that there is, in the fly, there's this protein called OSCAR, which we would call a scaffold protein, which then is required to localize these other proteins, VASA, TUDR, and aubergine. The interesting part is when you look into germplasm in a comparative way, these scaffold proteins are usually not conserved, but while these client proteins are highly conserved. So indeed, we talked just about Nancy Hopkins. So when Nancy Hopkins asked me, I want to find the germline in the fly, and I said, you know, just clone the VASA homolog, and sure enough, right? So this is, VASA has been in any organism. If you want to find the germline, whether it's, you know, vertebrate, invertebrate, mammals, whatever, you can find the germline. And the same for TUDR, and aubergine is a class of PV proteins, which again is highly conserved for transposable element control of transposable element mobility. And so we know from structural studies that were both carried out in my lab and in Anne Frusi's lab, how OSCAR interacts with these other proteins and how these proteins, for example, TUDR, has these so-called TUDR domains, which bind specifically to dimethylated arginines and interact with these components. So we have sort of an idea of how perhaps these granules are put together. However, there are recent very exciting ways of looking at these granules, which have no these membraneless granules. And the idea here is that these associations of molecules within cells are actually achieved by phase transitions, where a liquid phase goes into a more composed phase, which could be either a liquid droplet, which still can change very rapidly between and bleb, to hydrogels, which are really quite fixed and really gel-like, to fibrils like amyloid fibrils, which may also in certain cases be no longer be manipulatable, and that could lead to, for example, neurodegenerative diseases. And so these kinds of bodies, which kind of can be described as these various, and many of these experiments on this side, they're basically all in vitro experiments. And then there have been some experiments in cells, and we know that all of these, whether it's nucleoli, the nuclear pore, speckles, synaptic densities, and of course our germ granules, that they all have features of these kinds of phase transition lipid droplet properties, biophysical properties.
And so the important property is here that dependent on, it could be the temperature, it could be the concentration, obviously, but also pH, protein modifications, and then also in particular, the concentrations of RNAs, that this phase transition can undergo from something very evenly dissolved protein into these protein granules. Much of this has been studied, as I said, in vitro, often with a single protein and perhaps a mixture of RNAs. And we are thinking our germ granules are clearly bodies which are behaving perhaps like this, because I showed you within a single cell we had these uniformly distributed RNAs, and then they got really clustered, and the same for the proteins. But we do know that they're much, much higher structured. And what I want to tell you about today is how we're trying to understand the structural underlyings of this, of these, and really how these bodies could be functioning in vivo. And so the first is a daring experiment that an undergraduate in the lab did, where we just said, let's see if Oscar actually on its own can make granules. And so she just expressed the short form of Oscar, which is the form which is able ectopically expressed to induce all the steps to make germ cells. She expressed them in Schneider cells or in human cells. And what we found was that we find these granules, sort of round particles, form in the nucleus. And so this was very exciting because it tells us that we can probably start to assemble this pathway now. We can look by EM, and what was remarkable was when she did the EM sections and she sees these, they have sort of a kind of electron less dense inner, and then it sort of balls with this electron dense part outside. We found that Tony Maherwald already many years ago described these nuclear bodies. So we seem to be reflecting on something that is actually real and in the embryo. And then we asked the next experiment, is Oscar actually able to attract other proteins? And for this, we expressed VASA now, which we know, and normally it's associated with Oscar. We expressed it in the Schneider cells, but it doesn't form really granules. It's pretty, and it is in the cytoplasm. However, when we co-transfect it with Oscar, Oscar is able to co-localize it into these nuclear bodies. And so we don't really know what the function, we have some idea what the function of these bodies are, but we think in terms of somehow a reconstruction in the cell, we're now in a good way to do that. But what the real function of these proteins is really to localize these effector RNAs. And so the proteins associate with each other at an early stage of oogenesis, and I don't even have to tell you about that stage anymore because you saw it from Michelle's much nicer pictures, but here are the nurse cells, and they produce all the RNAs and proteins, and those get transported into the oocyte, and then their Oscar RNA starts to be translated here and then assembles all these other proteins. But then at a later stage, what happens is these nurse cells degenerate and they dump their contents into the oocyte. And during that time, there is a sort of washing machine rotation kind of in the oocyte. And this is when these RNAs become localized. And these RNAs get filtered out at the posterior pole in a non-active transport mechanism. So while Oscar RNA gets localized by an active transport mechanism, this is a non-active transport mechanism. And so these RNAs become localized. And so we are really curious how this happens. And these RNAs are really why the granules are important, because these RNAs are important for germ cell formation, specification, migration, germline genome stability. So they really fulfill all the functions that we associate with the germplasm. So the first thing I want to tell you is a result we obtained recently, which really turns the field of RNA granules and RNA transport a little bit on its head, because people are very protein-centered. I'm not. I have some friends here in the audience, I know. And they always think that the proteins are doing things to the RNA, but that's not true. I mean, we know the ribosome, you know, it's only the RNA which does something and organizes the protein. I'm going to tell you pretty much that for RNA localization. But it's been sort of the idea for RNA transport, and I'm sure anybody who's kind of heard about, you know, RNAs being transported around an axon, that, you know, the RNAs in an protein transport particle, and that gets transported, and that is due to specific interaction between the RNA and the protein. So it turns out when you actually ask what are the sequences in RNAs which are required for RNA localization, there are no sequence-specific motifs which have been identified. The only exception is ASH1, which is a yeast gene, where it actually found a little sequence in the coding sequence. Then there is, in actin, there is a sequence which is called the zip code binding, zip code, and then there's a zip code binding protein. But that sequence overlaps with translational regulators. So most of the sequence-specific sites in RNAs, which are sequence-specifically bound by proteins, are translational, but not RNA localization sites. We have spent a lot of time, a lot of people in my lab and many other labs, to find a code for localization, and no sequence-specific code has been identified. What has been identified is highly structured 3' UTRs. And so the star of this is Tatiana Trek, a postdoc in my lab, who really is leading all these experiments. And I was really lucky to recruit her. She came from Rob Singer's lab, and so she introduced the method of single molecule FISH analysis to my lab, so that we can now move the analysis to really a level of resolution using super resolution microscopy that was just not possible before. So the method is such that we label an RNA throughout the entire length of the message with, in this case, 48 probes, where each probe carries the same fluorophore. And so this allows us then to give, with hybridization conditions, that each of these molecules here, which are the molecules in the soma, each of this is a single RNA. So we can start counting the RNAs, and we can determine what the concentration of the RNA is in this region. And then here she can actually not count the single molecules, but she's estimating the number of molecules due to the fluorescence of these kind of granules here, or clusters, because we know what the fluorescence is of a single molecule. And we already knew from previous experiments that 3% of the total RNA localizes within less than 1% of the volume of the embryo. And what is the most important is probably the difference in molarity of localized RNA in this region to this region. And so if you are biochemically inclined, you will realize immediately that this difference in molarity totally changes the possibility of biochemical interactions. On the other hand, it also shows, and this is sort of explains to some extent that we almost didn't work on this project for 20 years, because if you do biochemistry of this, you're going to destroy this part. It's going to be diluted, and you're not going to analyze it. And so it's not surprising that a lot of the biochemical experiments have actually produced RNA binding proteins, but they really didn't help us to understand how the RNAs are localized. So now with imaging technology, we can sort of do biochemistry within the cell. We know a lot of the components, and so we can ask questions, what's really going on here? How are things organized in this germplasm? And so for this, Tatiana we aligned in an incredible collaboration with Harry Schroff at NIH, who built super resolution microscopy, SIM microscopy, and also with Timothy Lionett, who was at Genelia Farms, who works on building algorithms. And so both of this was incredibly important for us, because if you want to look at the relationship between two molecules at the level that we want to look at, and if that the region that you're looking at is really crowded, then two molecules are going to be likely overlapping, of course, because it's so crowded. And so the algorithm is really important and is really helpful. So we are measuring the peaks of fluorescence of our moieties that we're looking at. And then the important part is we're measuring the distance between the center of one fluorescence and the other. And we're giving a value to the consistency of the relationship between the distances. So this means if two molecules are highly enriched somewhere, but they have like, you know, no relationship to each other, the distance will not be constant and they will get a very low Pearson correlation coefficient a la Costes, which is this is named, while if two molecules have, even at a distance, but a very consistent relationship, they will get a higher value. And so when we do this, so this is just the images with, we look at two of the proteins, which I was already telling you that they are they have actually interaction, physical interactions with each other. And so Oscar and Vasa, these germ granule proteins, they totally overlap as far as we can tell. And I will now refer to the protein components as the granules. And then when we looked at the RNA, there was a big surprise because we always thought from EM analysis, and of course EM analysis only gives you a snapshot of a few molecules. It doesn't give you all of the molecules. We can see all of the molecules. And so, or we think we can see, let's see, most of the molecules. You should never say all, you know, dangerous. But the majority of the molecules. We see, so for example, when we use this RNA cyclin B, it looks like it's very good overlap. But when you look at this RNA, you see that the overlap is not particularly good. But it always seems like it's always kind of the relationship seems actually quite nice, and even for this case. And so, of course, we can quantitate this. And so first, some controls. Here is a control of an RNA which is not localized. So this RNA has a very varied relationship already to the distance from the VASA center. And here's sort of an idea of how big the granule, the radius of the granule is. And here's another control where actually it's not VASA, but it would be PGC here. So we labeled PGC RNA with two different fluorophores. So this is really telling us, because now we're labeling the same molecules, right? So this is just telling us what is the upper limit of our resolution. And so that gives you a good idea how nice the resolution is with it that we get with the ISIM. And so you can see here that, you know, it's about, you know, 20 nanometers, that resolution. And of course, in this case, we get really good, of course, they're localizing to the same RNA, so we get a very good Pearson correlation coefficient. The same is true when we're looking at Oscar protein as compared to VASA, which I already told you, it's kind of really the same protein. But when we were looking at the other RNAs, what we noticed is that this cyclin B was, the RNAs were in clusters, so in multiple RNA molecules, which were found in the center of the granule, while nanos, PGC, and germ cells were at different locations. And these are fixed locations from the center of the VASA granule. So what that tells you is that the protein makes this granule, but the RNAs are organized within the granule. So the RNAs are structured, and they're forming homotypic clusters because the same RNAs are finding their place somehow in this granule. So we were also curious, a given granule can have multiple RNAs, so we can use that to triangulate. So do we get the same result when we triangulate? And indeed we get specific. So this is now taking many, many granules and the locations and superimposing that. And so you see how we have these homotypic clusters and specific defined locations of these homotypic clusters. So what forms the homotypic cluster? So obviously all we know about RNA localization is that it's the 3' UTR which localizes the RNAs. So if the 3' UTR is the determinant for localizing the RNAs and making these homotypic clusters, we would suggest that it is only the 3' UTR which gives you the address to go where you have to go within the granule. And so what we did is, and it's the 3' UTR, I should mention, is not just required for RNA localization, it's also required for translational repression and then the derepression once the RNA is localized, and obviously it plays also an important role for RNA stability. And so what we then used, we used constructs we had available, which have the same 3' UTR, but they have different coding sequences. So now we can make two different fluorescent probes, fish probes, and ask, where are they going? And indeed, they went to exactly the same spot. They occupy the same position within the granule, and they maintain the same distance to other RNAs. So this suggests that it is homotypic interactions are occurring through the 3' UTR. So how could they occur through the 3' UTR? And so here comes the deviation from the saying, oh, it must be proteins, because somehow, remember, the proteins are everywhere, the RNAs are in certain locations. And so when we had all these data, we thought all of a sudden, oh, the RNAs could self-organize themselves. And this gives every RNA its own unique zip code. You don't have to think anymore of having 200 proteins or codes or whatever determining where the RNAs go. And so how could that work? So there's two possibilities how RNAs could actually interact with each other. One is through kissing, which means making two loops which are actually interacting, and this could obviously happen within an RNA, which has been discussed, but it could also be between RNAs. And this has already been shown for Bicoid and Oscar RNA in flies, and it's very common in viruses. And then there is a potential other which hasn't been explored as much and hasn't been proven as much. But there's another interaction, obviously, that the stem loops could open up and create secondary structures in trans rather than in cis. And so what's nice about this model is what kind of makes us feel that this may be the right way to go is that what we know about RNAs which are localized is that they have long 3' UTRs which are higher structured. That's all pretty much we know. And the other thing we know is that the proteins which play a role in RNA localization that have been identified are usually double-stranded RNA binding proteins with no sequence specificity, which you wouldn't need for these interactions because all you need is something to stabilize this or potentially a helicase which could open up these stem loops to give you space for these. And the other part that one could also imagine from this is the more complicated and the more structured an RNA is, the more interaction it could have with more other RNA molecules, creating those clusters that we see, which can have between 2-3 RNA molecules to up to 20 RNA molecules. So with this in mind, now we want to address the question. So we're doing a lot of experiments now in vitro, looking at RNA-RNA interactions, mapping these interactions. But what I want to convince you now in the next step, couple of slides, is that the RNA is instructive and the proteins are permissive. And I'll explain in this slide and a couple of other slides what I mean by that. So if the homotypic clusters were just a consequence of localization, you would imagine that the RNAs sort of get there and then they kind of eventually are being localized. If they are a mechanism of localization, we would imagine that the RNAs immediately keep on clustering and the clusters would grow. And so let's look at some experiments which sort of address those questions. So the first is, why is an RNA, where does the RNA get the information where it should be, whether it should be in the center or at the periphery? Is this something which has something to do with the proteins, or does it have something to do which is the quality of the RNA? And so what we found was that in general, there's a correlation between the size of the clusters and the concentration of the RNA. So the higher the concentration of the RNA, the bigger the clusters, but also the more in the center are the RNAs than the RNAs which have smaller clusters and smaller concentration. So what if we change now the concentration of the RNA? We're not changing anything on the protein. So when we half the amount of cyclin B, it shifts away from the center, and when we duplicate the amount or overexpress the amount of germ cells, it moves into the center. So clearly, the RNA can move. It is so a major determinant of the position within the granule is the concentration of the RNA. So the other point one could ask is, so if the RNA is really determinative and instructive and the proteins are permissive, then the size of the protein granule should really not matter with the size of the RNA granules, because the RNA granules should grow on their own because it's self-organization. They do need the protein initially to get stuck, but then they should organize themselves. And so when we look at the fluorescence of Oscar and Basa, and those are kind of our controls because those are the proteins, there's a beautiful correlation. You know, if you have a large Basa granule, then that's also a large Oscar granule, which is exactly what you would expect. But when we look at that correlation with nanos, there is absolutely no correlation with the RNA. That means you can have a large RNA granule with RNA cluster within a small granule. So there is no correlation between the proteins. So the proteins, while important for initially localizing, they're not important for the clusters. And so here is one other aspect which we find interesting, and that is to look with FRAP at the mobility of the proteins and the RNAs, whether they're actually behaving going together or whether they're behaving separately. And so when we're doing FRAP, photo bleaching experiments, we get biophysical behavior of the proteins, where we have a fast recovery. I think I have a fast recovery, a slow recovery, and then obviously components which are non-mobile. And we're interpreting this with, in particular, the largest fraction, that the slow mobility is this mobility of the fraction. Again, thinking about these pseudo-liquid or biogels that these granules are forming, where molecules can go in and out with a certain biophysical properties. So when we do these experiments looking at the proteins, we find that all the proteins have a particular mobility, which is actually, and recovery, which is very similar to the recovery that people have shown now for others of these biogel properties. But the RNAs, which we imaged here with labeling technique where we use a GFP labeled recognizing the RNA, has a different type of recovery, and so probably a different mobility. And so it is behaving not like the protein. So it has its own behavior, which again fits very much with that you're forming a cluster, and within the cluster you're actually having a much less of a mobility of the RNA. And so the model then is, initially, of course you need the protein. So if Oscar is mutated or Vasa is mutated, we will not get any RNA localization. And I showed you that the proteins are actually coming to the posterior pole before the RNA is coming there. So we have these proteins, and their proteins are absolutely important to seed the RNA. And we don't know at the moment why about 200 RNAs out of the 8,000 RNAs that are RNA species in the embryo are selected. And then what we think that after they're seeded, they start to recognize each other. And they're going to recognize each other more likely if they're higher concentrated, because it's all on the basis of RNA-RNA concentration and RNA-RNA interaction. So if you're higher concentrated, you should find yourself more likely at the posterior pole. And that may also be what gives you then the position in the center. And then they grow irrespective of, basically, they don't need the protein anymore, because then the growth of the cluster is really based on the on just the concentration of the RNA, and possibly we think on other properties of the RNA, like, for example, their complexity, how they can actually make these RNA-RNA interactions. And so, in summary, the germ granules are structured. We make these homotypic RNA clusters, which we are now very curious to see if that's happening in others. So if you look at a lot of the phase transition models at the moment, everybody has RNA in there, but their RNAs are kind of wavy. So we're waiting for seeing actually more people looking really at the RNAs with the kind of microscopy that we're doing in real life. It seems like the protein RNA components have different biophysical properties, which is exactly what you would expect if you have the RNAs actually interacting with each other. And so we can accommodate with this kind of idea that it's really all the information in the 3' UTR. We can accommodate many different RNAs. And what I didn't tell you about is that what's really strange is this RNA is translationally repressed. This RNA is translationally active. This one is translationally repressed. And this one's translationally repressed. And so there's no pattern for the localization. And so what we're, and if, for example, if this one represses actually that one, so nanos represses cyclin B, if you take, if you completely mutate nanos, have no nanos RNA, cyclin B is now translated and its position doesn't change. So that means that the position within the granule does not tell us anything about the translation. So what we speculate and what is the next kind of exciting step in this project is to figure out whether these RNA clusters organize their own translational machinery to some extent to these clusters. So now I want to, I hope, can I still have a few minutes? Yeah. Okay. So now I want to tell you something completely different. So if you don't care about RNA, and this is sort of, we're all lauding our own organism. This is really where I want to talk about using flies to do systematic studies. And I think, you know, I was always jealous. I'm a geneticist, and I was always jealous of yeast, or even bacteria, you know, where you can do these totally, you know, you can do screens in millions of animals, and so you really know at the end everything that can cause a phenotype. So in flies, that's difficult with old technology, which is mutagenesis analysis, mapping and all that, but it is now possible using RNAi and actually really just making generating at least a knockdown of every RNA, and you can really be more systematic. And so I'm going to tell you one story and where this kind of systematic approach also showed us something which we would have otherwise never studied. And so the question here is, you have a stem cell population, and that stem cell population differentiates. These are the 16 cell cysts that are building from a cystoblast, which is the product of the asymmetric division of the stem cell, where you have, of course, the renewal and then this differentiating cell, which then goes through these incomplete divisions and makes the cyst, which then will make the 15-ner cell and the one oocyte that we've talked about quite a bit this afternoon. And so if you think of just genetic model, how would I study this? What are the phenotypes for doing genetics here? There's two types of phenotypes for stem cells. One is where the stem cell cannot be maintained and you're going to lose the stem cell. And the other is where the stem cell can't differentiate and so you get a differentiation block. And so this could be a tumor, this could be another kind of block. And so this is a great project for all the graduate students here. Carlos was a graduate student in my lab. He just finished and is now doing his postdoc. And he recruited three postdocs to his project. Philippe, Thomas, and Jessica. And in particular, Philippe and Thomas, he really brought incredible expertise. So this was really an inter-laboratory collaboration. And so it started all off with us hearing about Greg Hannon's lab doing a whole genome's RNAi screen to find genes which are responsible for transposable element activation. And so what they had done is they had sequenced oocytes, figured out how many transcripts there were, that there were about 8,200 transcripts, and they ordered the RNAi lines, which can be are actually expressed, so we're not bathing or anything, we're expressing them specifically only in the germline using a very early germline driver, which is the nanoscal4 driver. And so what they did then, they looked at transposon upregulation, but they also looked at whether any germline was formed and whether any eggs were produced. And when I heard about this, I asked initially if we could get all the lines that they weren't interested in because transposable elements were not upregulated, but they had any of these defects, like egg laying defects or no germline were formed. And then later they finished their study and we got all of the genes that had any kind of oogenesis phenotype, and that came down to 883 genes, and that's when Carlos's work started. And that was an enormous amount of work that he did because he redid the crosses for those 883, knocked them each out, and then very carefully analyzed by immunofluorescence the different parts of the compartment. Are there stem cells? Are they differentiating? What is the phenotype? And so what he figured out then was that about half of the lines, so some of them didn't prove to give us a mutant phenotype, but 650 about still gave a nice phenotype, and half of them had no germline. And that's not so surprising because you would imagine that every gene you knock out which has a vitality phenotype for the vitality function for the cell will, of course, just the germ cells will just die, right? And then we had a very large percentage, a quarter, with early differentiation. We had very few egg chamber defects and later defects, and that's because our RNAi driver, the nanoscal4 driver, drives only very early in the stem cell compartment. That was lucky for us because we really were just interested in these groups. And so the no germline part was actually a really good component because, first of all, we could compare it with another screen which was done in the SOMA, and so we found that there was a large overlap, and probably most of these genes are general housekeeping genes. But what we really could use this for was also to calculate the false negative rate, and that's really important because you want to be complete. I was saying systematic screens. We want to have as few false negatives as possible. And so here's an example. So we got in dark red and lighter red is every component of the ribosome. I mean, of course, we knocked them all out. There's a few we did not. So the white ones actually were not screened. So some were not screened. There were no RNAi lines. But what is important are the ones which have no phenotype. So the gray ones, so they were screened and had no phenotype. That means that's a false negative because they should have had a phenotype. And from that, we can calculate then, maybe not all of them, but anyways, let's be generous. From all of these, we can then calculate what the false negative rate would be. And that is 20%. And that's perfectly fine. I can live with that. And the reason for that is that, you know, every good process has at least four or five components. So all we need, the systematic part here is to identify the networks, right? We don't live anymore in the life where you feel like you have to know every gene. It's enough if you have three components of the network. And actually, in some cases, we did this. We had three components. We said, oh, but this one's missing. So then we looked and we got another RNAi line and we figured out. So what's important is we want to get the networks. We want to get all the networks. And to some extent, it's kind of bizarre because now we are at the stage where we probably can say we know everything that's happening. We know all the networks probably. We just have to understand them. So the next was to look really at the phenotypes and the networks which were defined by these phenotypes. And in this case, we were particularly interested in differentiation defects. We're looking at the stem cell maintenance, but we have to go through that whole no germline group and figure out which ones are interesting and which ones are not so interesting. We're just doing that. And so one phenotype was very interesting because the stem cells made actually cysts, connected cysts, which indicates that normally we always thought that the cyst formation was a sign of differentiation, but it's actually not. It is the stem cells have to be prevented from making cysts. Another were tumors, which is really what we expected. You know, BAM was, so for example, the example, and we got this, and we got large tumors, and then we got smaller tumors, which were actually the TOR family.
normally, and that was also something we sort of expected. Actually, what was interesting here was all of this was ribosome biogenesis genes, and this we could narrow down to a critical component in the escort complex, which is important for the complete cytokinesis, is the rate-limiting component during this time, and that's why ribosome biogenesis genes have this phenotype. I'm going to only tell you about one phenotype, which was actually a phenotype we had not seen before, and in this case, the stem cells divide. They make a cystoblast, the cystoblast starts to divide and then dies before or around when it gets to the 16-cell cyst. And this was a really reproducible phenotype. But what was quite remarkable about this phenotype was that it was a lot of mitochondrial ATP synthase and proteins which produce mitochondrial proteins. And so here is the network, and again, we filled this gamma in eventually, and here's the phenotype. And it was quite interesting that it was actually Carlos would come every week and show me his book of horrors, and I was actually starting to say, oh, is this another ATP synthase mutant, right? And so, because the phenotype was so strikingly similar, so stem cells, they start to differentiate, and then they die very rapidly. And so the interesting part was, you know, of course, I mean, you're all going to say, oh, it's, you know, oxidative phosphorylation. But here comes the really amazing part about doing a systematic screen, which I really appreciated when Philippe, who was doing all the bioinformatics for this, presented these data to me one night. And the point is that if we had found a mutation in ATP synthase, I would have said, ATP synthase, they die, not interested. But this is the finding. So what's the amazing thing about a screen which basically hits everything is you can do the bioinformatics not only from your hits, you can also do it from the ones that you didn't hit because you know you hit everybody. So it's very different from a mutagenesis where you don't know, where it's random. And so it's the bioinformatics on the no hits, which was the most interesting. Because what Philippe showed was, so in gray, these are all the mitochondrial synthesized subunits, so obviously we can't hit those. But he showed that ATP synthase subunits, all the subunits had the same phenotype, while the oxidative phosphorylation parts that for the electron transport chain, which are obviously totally important for ATP synthase activity, they were not hitting in our screen, with a few exceptions. So you could say, yeah, you know, maybe they were all not working. So we reordered these and expressed them in the soma, and they all led to death. Maybe there are some which didn't hit, and it's probably back to our 20% that I was telling you. So this was very interesting. Why would ATP synthase subunits, or complex 5, would have a phenotype when all of the others didn't have a phenotype? And so here we were lucky, and so here Carlos went to the other postdoc, Thomas, who is an expert in mitochondrial biology, and asked Thomas, what does that mean, you know? And so Thomas first actually went on, to verify, to say, let's really see whether mutants have the same behavior. And indeed, when we now make mutations in ATP synthase, we see just the same behavior. They cannot differentiate. But what was more important, it was more the criticism that we were getting, was like, what? You don't need the electron transfer chain at all for oogenesis? And so when we made now mutants in the electron transfer chain and only knocked the genes out in the germline by using germline clones, they do make phenotypes, but they're much, much later. And they're kind of what I would have expected for ATP synthase or oxidative phosphorylation, which is, you know, they poop out sort of. They're not very interested from a developmental point of view. They just die. And so this is different, obviously, from our screen, because in our screen they kind of survived. And the point is, we're really lucky because we used an RNAi driver, which was really early. And so at these stages, that RNAi driver was actually no longer driving RNAi, and that's why they survived. So this was really good. But it also shows that these components, complex 1 to 4, which provide the electrons to ATP synthase to generate ATP, are not required at that stage. So it really shows that this must be something ATP synthase synthesizing independent function of complex 5. And so again, we kind of go, Thomas, what could it be? And then Thomas says, there's this other thing. There's this dimerization function of ATP synthase. So ATP synthase makes these dimers. And so we wanted to know if this is happening in the flies. We didn't know that. And indeed, these dimers are formed in the flies. And here you can see that the dimer is affected in the alpha and beta mutants, which are these, which are the absolutely important beta catalytic mutants. But they also affect each other's stability. But you can see these G and E and F mutants, they don't make dimers, but they still have a completely nice monomers, and they can still synthesize ATP. And these are tiny little subunits which are required specifically for the dimerization. And just keep in mind, these had very similar phenotypes to alpha and beta. So really telling us that there was something more important to the dimer formation. So what can the dimer do? So one function of the dimer is to bend the inner membrane of the mitochondria and make the cristae of the mitochondria. And so we asked whether that was deficient in our mutants. And so here are the cristae in wild type. And so when we knock out ATP synthase alpha, we get these cristae defects. And then when we knock out G, for example, we also get much less mature cristae. So how does that link back to the phenotype we observed? So the stem cells were fine, and it was this death all of a sudden when they were differentiating. So you would imagine that perhaps if cristae formation had some role with that function, that you would see maybe different cristae maturation state at this point or at that point. And indeed, this is now EMs from one section, but from different levels, and so the stem cells have very immature cristae, while the later stages have much, much more mature cristae. And so you would imagine that what you require here is you sort of require this differentiation. And if you can't differentiate, and you need the ATP synthase to help you, the dimers to help you to form the cristae. So if you can't make these cristae, you can't differentiate. So what we concluded from this is that, you know, you have low ATP synthase levels and low oxidative phosphorylation at the early stages, and then you make these cristae, which you now need for differentiation, but you don't need for oxidative phosphorylation. And this is really neat because this is a general phenomenon of stem cells. So, for example, this is ES cells. The cristae are really undifferentiated in ES cells, and then when they differentiate, you make cristae. The same I've seen for hematopoietic cells. Any stem cell population where EMs have been made, you see the stem cells are immature, and the more differentiating cells are more mature in terms of their cristae. This has been correlated with a need, predominantly glycolytic, being glycolytic in the stem cells, and then engaging in oxidative phosphorylation at the later stages. But we don't really know. What we would argue, and I'm going to, when I summarize, I'll argue, maybe you first need to make the cristae before you do go on to do really oxidative phosphorylation. And so there are many reasons. So how the dimers, of the role of the dimers. And so first of all, again, being a geneticist, I wanted a real separation of function mutation, and that is, so I showed you the G and E mutants where you don't have the dimer, but how about affecting ATP synthase function, but having a dimer and showing that that had no phenotype, right, at least early on. There are also hypotheses that the ATP synthase dimer is sort of making a channel for the permeability pore, which allows calcium to influx into the mitochondria. then it could be because you have the electron transport chain, of course, being working normally. You could have ROS, increased ROS signaling, and then there could be a cristae-specific function. And so we have gone step by step through these different functions, and I will just show you my favorite experiment, which is the separation of function experiment. Thomas dug out this paper from bacteria, a bacterial ATP synthesis, where they showed this C-ring, which accepts the electrons and then shoves the electrons towards the beta subunit for the energy for doing fusing the ATP to the phosphate. This C-ring rotates, and so it accepts the electrons. And it's composed of 9 to 11 subunits. We don't actually know exactly how many subunits there are in flies. And so they had, in bacteria, they had made this mutant, which was a dominant negative mutant, which basically put a wrench into that, into this rotation, and so blocks the rotation. And so you can just express that subunit, this mutated subunit, and thereby totally affect ATP synthesis activity. And so when we did this, we can show that ATP synthase activity is defective, but there is no phenotype in germline stem cell differentiation because they can still make the dimers, of course. There's no effect on dimer formation. So the permeability pore can actually be tested by cyclophilin, and so we did cyclophilin treatment. It does not affect cristae formation and has this later phenotype that I showed you. And we looked at ROS signaling by just looking at the amount of ROS, whether we had a mutant clone for ATP synthase or not, and we could not see a difference in ROS. So which led us then to really postulating that it is the cristae and not any other function, because we can't think of any other function at this point. Of complex 5. And so if it is the formation of cristae, then we can step aside and say, so are there other genes which affect cristae formation which have nothing to do with complex 5, but they should have the same phenotype then, right? And so for that, we turned to several mutations, but I'm just going to show you one group of genes, which are the prohibitants. And so they are make dimers, and these dimers make a ring, and the prohibitant ring then either integrates into the matrix or connects actually cristae, and they lead to a complete abolish cristae formation, the ability of cristae formation, and indeed prohibitant 1 or prohibitant 2 knockouts. Led to exactly the same phenotype as the phenotype that I was describing you for the ATP synthase phenotype. And again, we're getting these mitochondria which lack cristae. And so what we would like to propose then is, I was saying, you know, you may have this transition perhaps from stem cell to differentiation between glycolysis and oxidative phosphorylation, but we would like to propose that there is a checkpoint prior to it, and it makes kind of sense. You may not want to kind of investigate so much into going into the oxidative phosphorylation mode if you actually don't have the cristae to accommodate all those subunits that you need to have for that. And so we postulate that there is a checkpoint, that cristae formation maturation actually is a checkpoint, a structural checkpoint, and that if you cannot pass that checkpoint, you're going to die. The checkpoint, I think the definition of a checkpoint is always difficult. A checkpoint doesn't have to be instructive, but a checkpoint should be overcomable. So you should be able to overcome a checkpoint, and then everything should be fine. That's kind of my definition of a checkpoint. We have lots of discussions in the lab whether I'm over-interpreting here, but Thomas doesn't like it. But you know, but then he has made now lots of mutants which suppress this stage, so he's starting to call it checkpoint too. So. And can we extend this to other stem cell systems, obviously, and we're doing this with ES cells at the moment. And so here is our proof of principle that this is a checkpoint. And so the easiest, of course, when we overcome death, they should be differentiating, right? Because if this is a checkpoint. And so Thomas did the following experiment. So here's the ATP synthase. This is actually, this is a whole ovary. This is kind of the two ovaries. And you see just a few cells here. These are the stem cells before, just before they die. And then he knocked out caspase-9. And he gets complete recovery of the ovary. You may say, oh, but shouldn't they die at this later stage? But keep in mind, we're using the nanoscale 4, so the knockdown is only early and it's not late. The nice thing is, a fly, Michelle was talking about the abdomen. I mean, when a fly has a nice fat ovary, it has a nice fat abdomen. You can do a whole genome suppression screen with this. So Thomas is all set. He's going to the University of Toronto to start his faculty position, where he can do those experiments. What I just want to summarize is, the ATP synthase complex specifically is required for germ cell differentiation. I think we would have never found this unless doing a systematic analysis like we did. And so here is the combination of developmental biology and systems biology. ATP synthesizing function is actually upregulated. So ATP synthase is specifically upregulated during this differentiation. And it's not because there's more mitochondria at that time. And we need the cristae as a checkpoint for the differentiation. And here's a picture of my lab. And I want to particularly point out Tatiana, who was the person who really spearheaded the whole first part of the RNA organization. And then Carlos, who really did the lion's share of this work. And he was supported by Philippe Texera, who did a lot of bioinformatics and also worked very closely with Carlos analyzing the networks. He's on his way to the faculty position in Cambridge, England. And Thomas helped enormously with the mitochondrial work, and he's on his way to Canada. Lucky him. We got supported by a lot of funding, and again, Timothy Leinert and Hari Shroff were really important in the RNA analysis, and the Hannon Lab was incredibly important to get us started on this screen for genes. And thank you very much, and I'm sorry, I may have gone quite a bit over. Mark.
Ruth, with the homotypic RNA interactions, what happens when you make a hybrid 3' UTR? Like you've got PGC and nanos together, and then what happens to the endogenous RNAs as well? Do they get dragged on everything to the same place?
Yeah, we're just doing those experiments. Yeah. We have different kind of, it's interesting, right? Because, and where are they going to go? And, you know, can you, we're just doing that. It's kind of a nice experiment, yeah. Oh, question. Michelle.
Are there mutants that make extra mitochondria? And can you kind of rescue the block of not having enough cristae by having more mitochondria?
It's not about the function of the mitochondria, right? So they can probably still make, I mean, if they needed to make ATP, they can still make some ATP,
but
that's probably not the function.
But I just wonder if it would overcome the checkpoint if you had additional
I don't think so, because it's a checkpoint where you would have to have cristae, right? So the checkpoint is really cristae. It's not mitochondrial function. It is the cristae function, right? So we're thinking that somehow cristae formation is signaling to pathways, and we have suppressors which suggest what pathways, and that if you don't do that signaling, you're leading to cell death. And so it's really something, so the interesting part is, what is that signal? Is it, for example, when you make the cristae, that it's some sort of interaction between the inner membrane and so there are some ideas about the inner membrane coming closer to the inner membrane of the mitochondria to the outer membrane of the So it's sort of, at the moment, the best model is the physical interaction, because the prohibitin shows that, you know, that the prohibitin mutants actually, they have completely normal ATP. They can do ATP synthase. They have normal ATP synthase function, right? And so,
Thank you. So, and is there anything about the fission of those mitochondria that you think is important? So they look really elongated.
Yeah, so that is a completely different part that Thomas is very, very interesting because it has a lot to do with the selection of mitochondria. So we have a very nice idea now how mitochondria actually selected in the germline because it's clear that there is a selection step in which you select actually the good mitochondria, and the fission and fusion is a really important aspect for that. Can we go somewhere where it's warm? Maybe we can make a fire. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to say that.
I'm with you. I've been freezing. I have no hair. There's no further questions.
That's good.
I gotta speak normally.
Yeah, I think it's really is important that we get to where someplace warm. Well, this is supposed to be good for your immune system to be in a colder environment. So I'd like to thank all our speakers one again. Great presentations, a really nice theme through this, so I definitely appreciate the cells of my body even more. There is dessert in the back, and I think there might still be some coffee there, and please take advantage of that, and I think we might have a little bit left over. This closes our program. We do have gifts. To take home, so make sure you do. And if you don't want to take it with you, for some reason, we can mail it to you at that point. It's a look ahead, so it's a clock. So, no question there. Let's thank our speakers one more time. Thank you for coming. See you next year.